educated classes. Educated classes are the normal leaders of the Indian. Now, but this meant how this posed a problem, how will they mobilize people? Passing resolutions was all right, but the Dufferin made it clear that they wouldn't be listened to. There would be no entry opening of Indians into the civil service. There would be no greater grants for education. There would be no revision of syllabi, and so on and so on. And certainly there would be no opening of services to Indians at par with Englishmen. One of the demands was that civil service examination should be held in India and not in England, which of course would not be admitted. So all the demands were rejected. In such a situation, what could they do? So on tactics, which also determined then the strategy, as I will try to explain, they divided into two. One were called the old guard, the moderates, those who had formed the Congress. Hume, Malabari, Badruddin, Tayyabji, and others. Surendranath Banerjee, the silver-tongued orator. You know, these people wanted to persuade, to plead with the English public opinion, to mobilize educated Indians. You know, Curzon in a letter says, Mr. Surendranath Banerjee, the silver-tongued orator, came to see me in the morning. And he compared me to the greatest Indian rulers, Ashok and Akbar. Sir, Lord, my Lord, you are like Akbar and Ashoka and Akbar are two greatest rulers. It's interesting that his choice should be Akbar, or Ashok and Akbar. And he wanted Curzon to do something, and Curzon said, I did that. And he said, then he went, and in the afternoon addressed a large crowd, denouncing me, Curzon, as worse than Genghis Khan and Kublai Khan. So these were the, you know, moderates had their own strong points. They were orators. They could go to a drawing room and converse with English officials, and they could address large numbers of English understanding. But in English, Surendra Banerjee's main, by the way, he came to Aligarh in 1884. And actually, his speech was long remembered in Aligarh as one of the best speeches in English ever delivered. So we have our own connection with Surendranath Banerjee. Anyway, so these were the moderates. And their major figure was Gokhale, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, died in 1915. Gandhiji regarded him as his teacher, Gokhale. Now Gokhale was a very hard-working politician, very good in economics, very good speaker because of the facts. No English officer could answer speeches. He was elected from the Bombay Assembly to the Central Legislature. And it was said of him that he could be elected by any group of people, Muslims or Hindus. He was, he believed in modern values, and he believed that India can only flourish as a modern state, not as an old society. The other side was represented by Bal Gangadhar Tilak, T-I-L-A-K, also a Maharashtrian like Gokhale, who died soon after Gokhale in 1920. He was older than Gokhale, born, was born in 1856. Now, Tilak had an English education, but Tilak essentially did not believe simply he issued newspapers, he wrote in Marathi, he also wrote in English, but he believed that speeches and memorials were not enough, there should be popular mobilization. But how could mobilization take place? The educated classes had no links with ordinary people. Neither Gokhale nor Dadabhai Naoroji nor even Justice Ranade could arouse the mob. So Tilak then appealed to religion. And first he ran a campaign against the law against child marriage, saying that it was an attack on the caste system and also on Muslims, that it was an attack on the religion of Indians. He ran another campaign on plague, against plague inoculation, saying it destroyed castes and insulted Muslim women. You see, if you inoculate only men and not inoculate women, plague would not stop. So Muslim women had also to be inoculated. So Gokhale told Muslims, look here, you are allowing your zanana to be penetrated by English officers, getting their hands on the arms of your women. Where is your self-respect? So he made use of religion. Quite plainly. And in this religion, therefore, there was the other element. That if you use religions, religions abuse each other. So naturally, Tilak came to be identified more and more with Hinduism, particularly when he attempted a Shivaji cult, which is today continuing in Maharashtra. Brahmins before Tilak did not exalt, did not glorify Shivaji. There was a great division in Maharashtra, which again today continues to today. Their heroes were Peshwas, not Shivaji. Tilak changed all that. He established the Shivaji cult. And he said he justified Shivaji's treachery and murder by treachery because he said foreigners, and by foreigners he of course meant both Muslims and Englishmen here. For foreigners, you could take recourse to treachery. He was also tried for it. And ultimately, later on in 1906, he was sent to prison for 6 years. Now, Tilak's attempt to mobilize on religious grounds naturally raised the religious question within the national. And after 1895, Tilak and his supporters ceased attending the Congress because the Congress said that no resolution should be passed in the Congress session which does not have the majority support of people of all religious communities, separate religions. And otherwise also he was no longer on speaking terms with the moderates, the Gokhale and others. Now, Tilak of course remains a great figure. His religious divergence notwithstanding. Great figure because courageously he first raised the slogan of Swaraj, self-rule, which was translated into Urdu as Khud Mukhtari. Kul Khud Mukhtari, Purn Swaraj. And this was so influential that you know that Gandhiji, who was a disciple of Tilak, wrote Hind Swaraj, not Hindu Swaraj, but Hind Swaraj, Indian self, in 1909. In this Gujarati book, which is important, he tried to combine both the moderate and extremist elements. He denied that nation has any religious connotation. He said religion, nation has nothing to do with religion. Therefore, Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs and Parsis and Christians, he forgot Sikhs there, must live in unity. He also said that Hindus should not protest against concessions given to Muslims. see, Hind Swaraj is in many ways an important book. In 1909, Muslims were given weightage in voting a separate electorate and also votes in joint electorate. So in effect, they had double votes. And there were protests. Most moderates had also joined the extremists or Tilak supporters, as Tilak supporters were known in protesting. But Gandhiji said that it was wrong. It is wrong of Hindu leaders to protest against any concessions given to Muslims, because they are brothers, and if a brother gets more, the brother should not feel annoyed. So this was the message of Hind Swaraj. So actually Gandhiji was trying at that time to bring the idea of Swaraj to the forefront, which was in fact an extremist slogan, and at the same time try to put the moderate picture. The third element, which becomes the strength of the National Congress later, was that unlike moderates, Gandhi went to the poor in South Africa in the community. And it was this break, as we will see later, that is particularly important in the history of the national movement. But it comes much later. You see, don't talk only about the distress of the poor, go and organize them, which the earlier moderates were not able to do. Gokhale was not able to do. But it is particularly the achievement of Gandhi that he combined moderate aims with mass mobilization. But that we shall study later. Now, I have mentioned at the end some of the books. If there are any questions, I shall answer.
At the initial of your lecture, you told about imagined community. What's the concept behind this?
No, Benedict Anderson says that nation has no substance, in effect. Nation is just an act of imagination. And he takes the Latin American countries. You know, Latin American countries, except Brazil, speak Spanish. So they have the same language. They had a huge province, Peru. So they could have built up the nation around that idea of Peru. But no, they had small regions, and each region speaking Spanish, then of nation. Venezuela, Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, and so on. So he said these are all imagined communities. There was no reason why Venezuela should be separate from Bolivia. But this, of course, is arguable because of the geographical divisions in Latin America. I mean, Latin America is broken up through mountains in a way that India is not broken up. The second argument is that nationalism is really owing to the printing press. Printing press popularizes slogans. So you tell the people that you are a Bolivian, and all of them then believe that they are Bolivians and therefore they. So if the printing press comes, then nationalism comes. You mean, these are all well-known facts. It is nations have been helped by printing press, by newspapers. The ideas spread. They are also helped by geography. But what Benedict Anderson forgets, that these Latin nationalists were opposing Spanish imperialism. They were opposing, there was a similar drain from Spain to, from Latin America to Spain and Portugal. And recently, I think it was the president of Ecuador, I think, or Bolivia, perhaps, Bolivia, who calculated the drain, the tribute that Latin America paid to Europe from 1492 onwards. And this is astronomical. If Latin America wants this tribute back from Europe, even of 100 years with interest, Europe will go bankrupt despite this. So there was this economic pressure on Latin America, which these people wanted to overthrow. There were other elements of nationalism also, which Benedict Anderson doesn't pay attention to. Bolivars and others, real feeling for the Amerindian people, which did not continue after them, but they wanted a country in which Amerindians and Europeans were equals. And that too was an important factor in their nationalism, which disappeared later and then has been revived in this century. And now, of course, it's the main basis for the left in radical in Latin America.
You mentioned in your lecture that Sir Syed Ahmad Khan said that how these gentlemen are tolerating sitting with darjees.
How would they tolerate?
Yes, we're sitting with darjees. And why he used this terminology? Was darjees at that time very inferior?
Well, that was that I've been thinking. Why darjees? Why not, for instance, dhobis, in which modern Muslim middle class idiom is worse than dhobis in darjees? I remember in my school in Mentor Circle, dhobi was the word used for a person you did not like rather than darzi. But you know, these idioms change. And how do they change with time? I remember if somebody called another chamar in Mentor Circle, there would be a fist fight. Today, I think it would be, I would immediately claim a scheduled caste privilege if I am so called. So these things change, idioms change. Allow these people to come in, he says.